Recorded Books and One Click Digital present A Haven on Orchard Lane by Lawana Blackwell. Narrated by Beverley A. Crick. Chapter 1. If one would drown one's sorrows with music, the music must be loud. On the 17th of February 1880, if Charlotte's fingers had not pounded out Haydn's Andante with variations in F minor so forcefully, the score would not have slipped from its stand. She would not have heard hoofbeats. They halted in the snow-frosted carriage drive instead of carrying on to the stables. Visitors were rare, thus curiosity led her from grand piano to window. She pushed aside a curtain and watched a coach sway to a stop behind a pair of horses. The driver hopped down from the seat and opened the door. His passenger stepped to the ground, looked up at the house. She could almost read his expression. Her first sight of 16th century Fosbury Hall had taken her breath away, with its four stories of honeyed limestone, gables and projecting windows, and veranda with wide steps. Charlotte crossed the Belgian carpet and eased open the parlor door. Alerted by a bell in the kitchen, Mrs. Trinder moved soundlessly up the hall.
"Good morning," the man's voice resonated from the porch. "My name is Milton Perry, calling for Lady Fosbury. Here is my card."
"I'm afraid Lord Fosbury is away."
This was news to Charlotte, but Roger was not one to inform her of his comings and goings, nor was she one to ask.
That's quite all right. As I said, my business is with Lady Fosbury."
"Lady Fosbury's not available," Mrs. Trinder said, and began closing the door.
The male voice quickened from Andante to Allegro.
"I have an urgent message, if you would but—"
"Here I am, Mrs. Trinder," Charlotte sang, stepping into the hall.
Mrs. Trinder turned, cheeks as ashen as her hair, veined hand still grasping the knob.
"Lord Fosbury insists upon receiving guests in person, your ladyship."
"The gentleman appears to be my guest."
"But—"
Charlotte stepped closer, touched her shoulder. "I'm still the lady of the house. Now, if you please." The housekeeper stared at her for a moment before moving aside. The visitor at the threshold was well-dressed in a black Chesterfield coat. From a high forehead flowed oiled salt and pepper hair, dented from the crown hat tucked inside his arm. Above a trim beard, his cheeks were ruddy from the cold. One gloved hand held a narrow leather satchel.
"What an honour, Lady Fosbury," he said, with a little bow.
"Thank you."
She took the proffered card from his gloved hand. Milton Perry, it stated. The urgency in his hazel eyes intrigued her, and after all, she had not had a caller in 2 or 3 years.
"Come in, Mr. Perry."
"Thank you."
She stood to the side.
"Will your driver care to wait in the kitchen?"
Stepping into the hall, he replied,
"You're very kind, but I shan't be long, and he has rugs."
Mrs. Trinder watched with an aggrieved expression, not offering to take his hat and coat. Charlotte did not have the heart to force the issue.
"Wait and remove your coat in the parlor where it's warmer."
She led him down the hall and opened the door. Mrs. Trinder, lagging behind, cleared her throat and said when Charlotte turned,
"His lordship will be displeased."
"I'll explain to him that I insisted, that I bullied you, Mrs. Trinder. Will that suffice? Now please, return to your duties."
In the parlour, Mr. Perry stood before the fire in pinstripe suit, his coat, hat and gloves draped across a sofa arm.
"I had forgotten how cold the north can get."
She seated herself in one of the plush green Venetian chairs. Mr. Perry came over to fold his limbs into the adjacent chair, resting his satchel upon his knees.
"You manage that situation well, if I may say."
Tempting it was to explain. "Mrs. Trinder is pleasant on the whole, but as she has been in my husband's employ for 30 years, she naturally defers to him." But this visitor was a stranger. Enough of Charlotte's private life had been bandied about over the years.
"What brings you here, Mr. Perry?" He nodded.
Mrs. Perry and I had the pleasure of seeing you in several productions. You had such presence on stage.
That raised in her no small suspicion. Was he a reporter? If so, she would show him the door, then apologize to Mrs. Trinder. You're very kind, and once again, may I ask the purpose of your visit?
But of course.
He took an envelope from the satchel and left his chair to hand it over.
I own a courier service in London.
Charlotte's breath caught at the sight of the return address. The Lyceum.
Mr. Irving sent 2 telegrams himself before contacting me,
Mr. Perry said, seated again.
I dispatched a messenger here on Tuesday, but he was turned away.
Henry Irving took over management of the Lyceum 2 years ago, according to the Times. She had shared the stage with him on several occasions, most recently 8 years ago as his mother Gertrude in Hamlet. Charlotte worried the edge of the envelope with her thumb. Her hopes had been dashed so many times. Stalling, she said, I received neither telegram nor message.
So he assumed.
Mr. Perry hesitated.
Is it possible your husband...
She felt a sick chill. It is not only possible, but probable.
I'm sorry to hear it. In any event, I'm not as easily intimidated as my staff, and as dependability accounts for the success of my business, I caught the very next train to Lincolnshire.
Impressive, but what if my husband had been here? Mr. Perry smiled.
Over an hour ago, I hired a local courier to deliver a message from one Maxwell Simpson, Esquire, requesting an audience with Lord Fosbury over a matter of supreme importance at 3 Horseshoes in Halton Holgate.
I was playing the piano and did not hear, but pray, who is Maxwell Simpson?
My sister's husband in Yorkshire. I dare say he'll miss the meeting.
Charlotte smiled. How good it felt to do so. Mr. Perry's brows drew together.
Which leads me to ask if our hijinks will cause you any harm. Is Lord Fosbury a violent man?
He is not. Roger's wit was his weapon of choice. She gave that a second thought. Roger would connect Mr. Perry with the fool's errand. He owned guns for hunting. Surely he would not use them against a person. But then his behavior had surprised her before. Still, she went on, you mustn't tarry. I'll read this after.
Will you read it now? Mr. Irving awaits your reply.
Pulling in a deep breath, she opened the envelope.
Dear Charlotte, I pray this finds you in excellent health. And I dare to hope, would you care to take a break from country life to play Gertrude again? An unfortunate attack of palsy has forced Mrs. Rathbone to quit midstream, and while Mrs. Overton is a competent understudy, she has not the audience loyalty you commanded. A prompt and favourable reply would put me forever in your debt and bring joy again to London audiences.
Her nausea gave way to lightheadedness. She had read in the Times weeks ago of the revival of Hamlet at the Lyceum, never daring even to dream she would be associated with it. He offers me a part. Mr. Perry smiled and withdrew more papers from the leather case.
He sends the script so that you may refresh your memory.
She took it from him and pressed it between her hands. She could almost smell the gaslights.
I'm authorized to purchase a railway ticket and would consider it a privilege to escort you to London.
London. How wonderful would it be, Charlotte thought, to have a reason to wake in the morning. To go through the day free of self-recrimination for having blundered yet again into the biggest of mistakes. To be with people. And yes, to see Charlotte Ward upon the marquee. The dream faded like stage fog. While her face was free of wrinkles but for the corners of her eyes, and her ash-brown hair only enhanced by the few strands of grey, there was another issue. She pressed her elbows into her sides and felt the flesh yield. I've gained 2 stone at least. They're unaware.
You're still beautiful, Lady Fosbury.
Not enough. Audiences would not fault her for her 50 years. 51 in August. After all, the part was for a grown man's mother. Yet they would expect someone attractive and regal. Mr. Perry was a stranger, but there was no one else in whom to confide her angst.
I've let myself go. Terribly. I'm fat.
I must disagree.
Yes, you must, she said with a frown, because a gentleman is constrained to say otherwise.
On the contrary, I'm unfailingly honest, he winced, my brother-in-law's fictitious message notwithstanding. If I may be so bold, you're, well,
Rubenesque.
Rubenesque, what every woman wanted to hear. With knees creaking, she heaved her Rubenesque body to its feet. Please convey my deepest regrets to Mr. Irving, if you will see yourself out. She, who could produce copious onstage tears, wanted no witness to those now prickling the backs of her eyes. He rose slowly.
Should you not speak with him, at least?
Attempting to say a word would unleash the flood. She pressed her lips and nodded toward the door.
I'm sorry to have distressed you.
Mr. Perry collected coat, gloves and hat and backed across the room. Just before the doorway, he paused.
Lady Fosbury, my dear wife is a stout woman. I dare say she weighs much more than do you.
Charlotte could pull in only shallow breaths.
She purchases certain undergarments at ladies' shops to make herself appear smaller.
That was the icing on the cake. Of course, she knew of corsets, but she had never needed one. 100 years ago that life seemed.
Why will you not leave?
Mr. Perry was the epitome of male discomfort, eyes not quite meeting hers, fingers plucking at coat buttons.
Forgive my indelicacy, but it would be a tragedy if you gave up without a try.
The tears eased, though the back of her throat ached. A fireplace log collapsed with a hiss into the bed of ashes.
How can it hurt? He asked.
How could it hurt? In so many ways. She had only to picture Henry Irving rejecting her. The return train ride. Roger's smug look.
I'm afraid that I'll fail.
He nodded.
I understand. I do. For years I kept books for Harrods, chained by fear to a job that I despised. One day I realized it was far better to fail than to spend the rest of my life wondering what would have happened if.
If. She imagined herself in the years ahead, browbeaten into a shadow of the woman she once was, sick with longing for paths she had not chosen. Drawing in a deep breath, she said,
When does the first train leave tomorrow?
His brows rose.
Why, at 8. Shall I come for you?
I will meet you. My husband will not welcome you back onto his property.
That's sooner than I could have hoped. Will you not need more time?
The thought of more time was not appealing, considering that it would be spent beneath the cloud of Roger's anger. Besides, more time would give footholds to fresh doubts. She shook her head.
Very well, Lady Fosbury. I'm staying at Red Lion Inn, should you need to contact me.
She glanced toward the window.
You must go now.
He thanked her and left. As hoofbeats sounded again, Charlotte sank to her knees, rested her head against a soft cushion, and wept. The spiritual numbness that had gripped her for so long loosened its hold. God had not forgotten her after all.
Dearest Father, how good it felt to pray.
She had been a believer since age 14. A common assumption was that actors and actresses led immoral lives. Many did, which was the reason her circle of friends in the profession had always been small. But her parents were faithful churchgoers, no matter how late a Saturday show ended, and no matter where the tour had them temporarily planted. Over her mother's constant but pragmatic Anglican objections, her father chose whichever congregation was near enough to the theatre to allow them to be in costume for the Sunday matinee.
Thank you for your kindness in spite of my wallowing in my own misery. Now please give me the strength to do this.
Chapter 2. Charlotte spent the remainder of the morning laying out clothes. She could have assigned the task to upstairs maid Alma Willis, but word might have gotten out. She wished to speak with Roger before sending for her trunk. A rap at the door gave her a start. Alma's voice came through.
Shall I bring up a tray, your ladyship?
Yes. Charlotte eyed the clothes upon the bed. On second thought, I'll go myself. A single impulse propelled her down the stairs, past gilt-framed and somber Fosburys from generations past. Food. Tight nerves made her ravenous. Savory aromas greeted her in the panelled dining room. The table stretched out to accommodate 16, but the cloth was laid with one place setting. Footman Jack Boswell hastened in, slump-shouldered and seeming older than his 30-odd years. He had been doing the work of two ever since a financial snag had forced Roger to sack the second footman, along with the butler, undergardener, and two housemaids.
I beg your pardon, your ladyship, he panted. Lord Fosbury ordered a tray in the library.
That's quite all right. She slipped into the chair he held out for her. As he moved over to the sideboard, she said,
Has God ever surprised you, Jack?
Surprise me?
He lifted the soup tureen and shook his head.
I can't say that he has.
Well, you're young.
Begging your pardon again, but I feel anything but young.
Charlotte clucked her tongue sympathetically.
Don't give up your faith, Jack. I learned today that we cannot imagine what's around the corner.
Yes, your ladyship, he said with little conviction.
How could she fault his lack of optimism when Roger insisted upon carrying on as if Fosbury Manor were fully staffed? With just the two of them, they could make life easier for the servants, but her suggestions were brushed aside. Meals, for example. There was no reason they could not serve themselves from the sideboard for every meal, not just breakfast. But what a relief that Roger intended to sulk. Food and terse discussion did not mix well. And she could have seconds without having to endure his comments. Seconds. She had not even had soup, and she was anticipating seconds. In spite of a huge breakfast just hours ago. Was food more important than this opportunity handed to her? But there was not time to shed but 2 or 3 pounds, she reminded herself, for she could be on stage within the week. Better than gaining 2 or 3. There seemed no in-between.
Jack?
He paused halfway from the sideboard with a steaming soup dish upon a tray.
I believe I would care for tea only.
Tea, your ladyship?
Yes, black, and on a tray that I can carry upstairs.
With a sandwich?
His surprise was almost comical.
Biscuits?
No, thank you.
She had to flee these aromas from whichever delights waited under covered platters. With tray in hands and head held higher, she again passed the stairs of Fosbury ancestors. No food had ever tasted sweeter than this victory. 2 hours later, Charlotte found her husband in the conservatory, fussing over his beloved pink, red, and white camellias.
Roger?
I'm occupied, he said.
Something important requires your attention.
Are there no hams in the larder that require your attention?
He chuckled at his own witticism and waved a hand with a flourish.
No cakes in the bread box, no tarts in the window.
He can't hurt you anymore, she said to herself, yet felt the sting. Roger Fosbury, Viscount of Spilsby, was a mildly handsome man for his 60 years. A trim 6 feet tall, with fading auburn hair as thick as a young man's. He had been widowed 2 years when Charlotte met him at the wedding of his niece, once removed, actress Lily Langtry.
"You'll adore Uncle Roger," Lily had enthused those 5 years ago. "He was so tender with Aunt Helen when she was struck with a cancer."
After years of resisting matchmaking attempts from friends and direct flirtations from men, Charlotte found herself charmed by Roger's devotion to his late wife and his talk of his life on an estate in Lincolnshire. She could imagine reading in the garden, picnicking on the riverbank, gathering berries in the woods, breakfasting in the conservatory, strolling through golden fields, going to village fairs, wholesome activities she had read of in novels but never had time to pursue. After decades of pretending, what would it be like to be simply herself? After two marriages to actors whose moods were tied to the volume of the applause they received, how would it be to have a companion with nothing to prove? The newspapers made much of the wedding, quiet affair though it was. The caption in the Times read, "Charlotte Ward becomes Lady Fosbury of Spilsby. Third time lucky." During those first halcyon months, Roger taught her to play chess, to ride, to tell the difference between a larkspur and a delphinium. He brushed her hair evenings and asked to hear her theatre experiences. They shared a hymnal during services at St. James. He encouraged trust so much that she allowed herself to cry on his shoulder over the losses she had experienced. He knew of loss as well, and the comfort they gave each other strengthened their bond. She had not minded his disinterest in entertaining. They were lovers, cocooned by polished walls and pampered by servants. The times he was away seeing to tenants and farms, she simply read, took walks, played piano. It was the beginning of their second year, when she was as besotted as a young maiden, that he came to her in tears.
"I so wanted to spare you this, Charlotte, but I'm on the verge of bankruptcy. I've become a cliché. Land rich, capital poor."
None of his doing, he assured her. The price of wheat had fallen. If he did not lower rents, he would lose farmers to rising factory wages in Norfolk. He could not sell off some of his land because the estate was entailed. She was glad he had come to her. Having paid her own way most of her life, she was beginning to feel like a kept woman. The estate was her life, too. Ignoring a little warning voice in her head, she cleaned out her account, over £600. She commissioned the sale of her London townhome, bringing in another £100. To do otherwise would have been to admit she had sold her birthright for bad pottage. Yet again. Perhaps Roger had not married her for money, she thought, watching him inspect a leaf for who knows what. Perhaps self-loathing lay at the root of his increasing coldness, humiliation for having had to ask for help. Or it could be that he had grown resentful that she was not Helen, the love of his youth. Whatever his reason, he had chosen not to share it. Silence was cruelest for the monsters it bred. As intimacy waned, food became more than sustenance. It became her solace. He mocked her lack of restraint and the bloating of her body, complained at having to pay a dressmaker to alter gowns and, eventually, sew new ones. He undermined her confidence piecemeal, so by the time she realized she would never see her money again, she could not think of returning to London. Until today.
"I've been offered a part in Hamlet," she said,
as if he had not read the telegrams. He straightened, and his brown eyes mocked her.
"As what, dearest? The castle?"
"You will not take this away, Roger," she said, over the bile in her throat. He plucked a white camellia, twirling it in his fingers.
"Out of the question, Charlotte. I'll not have my family name subjected to ridicule."
"I would use Ward, as I have from the beginning, my family name."
"Everyone knows I'm your husband. You will not make a fool of me."
She swallowed and forced breath into her lungs. "That would be the utmost irony, wouldn't it?" Snorting a bitter laugh, he dropped the bloom to his feet.
It was the error that made fools of the both of us.
The theatre paper? She blinked. What does...
I never read such rubbish, but Helen subscribed to follow Lily's career. She read an article to me about how the Shah of Persia was so moved by a performance that he gifted you a ruby.
A ruby?
Stored in a vault in the Bank of London and insured by Lloyd's of London for £15,000.
A sharp laugh left Charlotte's throat. You believed this? He shrugged.
I never read where you denied it.
I would have had no time for my career if I had tracked down and denied every falsehood. It would have been futile in any case. Most people want to believe the sensational. Why did you not ask about it before we married?
His silence spoke volumes. Any questions about her finances would have aroused suspicions. She had prided herself on her ability to spot fortune hunters. Pride truly did go before a fall, as scripture warned.
Were no wealthy widows pursuing you? Charlotte asked. You're a handsome man, but for the coldness in your eyes when your true nature reveals itself.
There were some, he shrugged. Lady Blake.
Lady Blake, who wore a different stuffed bird on her hat every Sunday.
He had the grace to look embarrassed.
So she's fond of birds.
I expect the birds would dispute that.
Charlotte sighed.
Then why me?
Another silence, but the fictitious ruby had taken on a life of its own and stood between them.
I'm grateful your little gift helped me keep the estate, mind you, Roger said at length. I have but to wait out the price of wheat, and this place will be restored to its former glory.
She felt no remnant of love, but that he could be so blasé about taking her savings stung more than any insult he had ever thrown her way.
What I cannot understand, he went on, head leaned thoughtfully, is why you had so little in light of your successful career, the ruby notwithstanding.
I have a successful career, she corrected. I'm going to London.
You neither drink nor gamble, he went on, and your house was modest, all things considered. You own few baubles.
What had she done with the bulk of her money? Had he but asked, she would have explained. If he had really known her, he would have figured it out long ago. For such a self-congratulatory man, he could be quite obtuse.
I'm going to London, Roger, Charlotte repeated. In the morning.
Well, there's the rub. How will you get to the station?
The landau, of course.
He shook his head.
Allow me to disabuse you of that notion.
What do you mean?
My landau, my driver, my horses.
You're not serious.
Utterly serious. You're free to walk. 12 miles would do you some good.
You can't keep me prisoner, Roger.
His brown eyes narrowed.
By the by, I sent my own message to your prankster, Mr. Perry, that you've changed your mind.
Charlotte felt as if the breath had been knocked out of her. Mrs. Trinder must have listened at the door.
And that I shall have him arrested if he trespasses again. Chief Constable Bickerton and I were boyhood schoolmates. Have I never mentioned that?
I will not allow him to see me cry, she thought, even as tears stung her eyes, blurring his face. Why? She said thickly. You don't even like me.
Nonsense. You're my wife.
He could have commented on the weather for all the affection in his tone.
But in due time, if you choose to leave, I'll not prevent it.
Due time, meaning when Hamlet's run was over. He nodded as if reading her mind.
I forbid you to make a laughing stock of me. London papers are sold in Lincolnshire too, as you're well aware.
Roger, she swallowed past the lump in her throat. I'm begging you.
Enough, Charlotte.
He returned to inspecting his camellias.
You'll thank me one day when you return to your senses.
The sound of soft rapping penetrated Charlotte's mind. She opened her eyes. They burned as if rubbed with sand. It was incredible that she had managed to fall asleep across the cluttered bed.
"Your ladyship,"
came from the door. Charlotte lifted her head. Her neck ached from using her arm for a pillow. Beyond the open curtains, the frigid winter had sunk into early dusk.
"Go away, please, Alma."
Yet the knob turned and the door eased open. Alma entered, carrying tray and candle. Closing the door with her foot, she said,
"I brought supper."
"I'm not hungry," Charlotte said, raising herself to sit.
"Yes, your ladyship."
Alma set the tray upon the dressing table bench, lit the bedside table lamp, turned, and smiled. She was 26, tall and thin, with a light brown topknot and unfailingly equable disposition.
"Alma, I have no appetite."
Charlotte's throat, however, was parched.
"Just some water."
The maid filled a beaker from the carafe. As Charlotte drank, Alma said, louder than necessary,
"Now then, see what lovely trout with Dutch sauce Mrs. Fenn made, and some nice artichokes with poached eggs."
Charlotte saw no such thing, only Alma's face looming close.
"Oswald will take you to the railway station," she whispered, "if you wish to go." "But how?"
Charlotte whispered when she could speak.
"He'll be waiting at the veranda at 4 in the morning."
"Why would he?" Stable boy Oswald Green was an affable young man, but her interactions with him were limited, especially since Roger had stopped taking her riding.
"Lord Fosbury sent him to town with a message, and the man he brought it to offered him a job. He's to send a coach. What shall I say to Oswald, yes or no? You can't bring a trunk."
A trunk meant nothing compared to freedom. But there was another factor to consider. She would be burning bridges. Roger would never allow her to return. What then if Henry Irving deemed her too large? She had but £6 sterling and some loose coins. The knot in her stomach grew. As unpleasant as the now was, the future's pitfalls were shrouded in fog.
"Show me what to do, Father."
No voice spoke from a burning bush. No heavenly vision appeared. But in her mind's eye, she envisioned herself on her knees in the sitting room that morning, gushing a prayer of thanks. If she believed this opportunity to be a gift from God, she must not balk, because it was not wrapped in layers of certainty. She took Alma's rough hands.
"Yes."
Alma smiled.
"Shall I help you pack?"
"No, the less time you spend with me, the better. And if this causes you any trouble, write to me in care of the Lyceum Theatre."
"I shall be fine."
Withdrawing her hands, Alma stood straight again and said in a louder than necessary tone,
"Will you not eat, Lady Fosbury?"
"I have no appetite."
She adored trout, but her insides were so racked that there could have been an anthill in the dish for all the appetite it induced. Which was fortunate, for the quest to shed some weight was renewed. Alma took the tray and sent her another smile from the doorway. Charlotte stared at the closed door and fought temptation to call her back. Fear rattled its bones at her like a gruesome skeleton. She was limited to what she could carry. She rose, lit another lamp, and opened the door to her wardrobe. Standing upon tiptoe, she latched onto the handle of her French Morocco leather traveling bag and tugged, catching it in her arms. It would be her only luggage, with space for hair and toothbrushes, underclothing, a nightgown. But first, moving over to the belongings spread upon the bed, she opened the lid to a flat rosewood box and moved aside papers stiff with age. The oval frame was tarnished, but she had been warned long ago that to take it apart for polishing would damage the sepia photograph. She held it to her cheek for a moment and then packed it into her bag through a haze of fresh tears. Chapter 3
Charlotte did not return to bed, lest she not wake. Her mind was beset with doubts and fears in any case. Bag packed, she sat at her writing table and read the play script. The lines came back to her.
Your mercy overwhelms me, Father.
From 2 until 3 o'clock, she glanced often at the mantelpiece clock, wishing the hands would hurry. At 3, she padded to the bathroom. She cleaned her teeth, bathed with face cloth, and fastened her hair into a fresh chignon. Back in her bedchamber, she pulled on a sea-green poplin gown that would travel well, a grey wool coat with hood, and calfskin gloves. She wondered then which shoes to wear. The clock struck 4:15.
You should have thought of this hours ago.
She would have to move through the house in stocking feet. There would be no time to button her warmest boots on the veranda. She decided upon the worn, low-cut Balmoral boots with the elastic side gussets. They would fit more easily into the top of her open bag as well. Taking up holder and candle, she eased open the door, moved the bag through it, stepped out, and closed it just as quietly. Years of having to be silent offstage paid off, for she knew to place her weight upon the pads of her feet. Darkness magnified the silence, as well as the thumping of her heart. The hall clock chimed 4 as she started downstairs. Without a free hand to grasp the banister, she resisted the temptation to hurry. She crept into the silence of the entry hall and opened the door. Frigid air assaulted her and blew out the candle. Charlotte had no choice but to carry on in the dark, setting bag upon veranda to close the door. The stone below felt like ice through her wool stockings. She knelt to feel for the boots in the top of her bag and pulled them on. There was no sign of Oswald in the velvety blackness. She could not be more than 5 minutes late. Had he assumed she had changed her mind? Or had he changed his? He was surely as anxious as she was.
Please, Father, he has to come.
She prayed, even as her eyes caught sight of a flickering in the distance, past the row of windows at the east corner of the house. As still as held breath, she watched lamplight sway slightly to and fro. She recognized Oswald's lanky form when he was some 40 feet away, though a hat covered his carrot-red hair. She felt her way down the 3 low steps and met him. With her free hand, she gathered up as much of her coat and gown as she could manage. He held a bag as well. They slogged through 6-inch snow, past the carriage drive into the lane, where bare linden branches loomed. She was full of questions, but held her tongue. At length, he whispered in a cloud of vapour.
I'm sorry I cannot carry a bag, your ladyship. Can you walk a mite longer?
Yes,
she whispered back, though the cold tormented her feet. They continued on for what seemed an hour, shivering and panting, but what was more than likely 10 to 15 minutes. She looked over her shoulder. No windows were illuminated in the mass of blackness.
Not much longer, he whispered. They cannot come too close to the house.
Finally, they reached Ashby Road. They turned to the west, towards Spilsby, walking in the middle between hedgerows. She saw light ahead, heard the soft whinny of horses. Several paces more, and a coach appeared. A dark form hopped down from the lamp-lit driver's seat. As a man entered the light from Oswald's lantern, Charlotte recognized him from having delivered Mr. Perry yesterday.
Lady Fosbury, I'm Guy Heaton.
He helped her into the dark coach.
My apologies, but the road is too unsteady to attach a lamp in here.
True to northern dialect, he pronounced road as road.
But there are rugs to warm yourself, he went on.
Thank you, Charlotte said, voice shivering.
Inside the coach, she unfolded a wool rug and burrowed herself to the neck. Oswald leaned his head in to set the bags upon the floor.
I'll sit with the driver.
Must you? I'd rather not be alone.
Of course, your ladyship.
He spoke to Mr. Heaton and then came inside and wrapped himself in a rug. With creaks of wood, the wheels began a slow trundle. About a mile up the road, the team picked up speed to a trot.
"It's too dark to run them," Oswald said, "but we've plenty of time."
"It's a wonder they can see it all," Charlotte said, relieved at not having to whisper, yet struck by the strangeness of her voice, as if she had not spoken for days.
"Horses can see better in the dark than people."
Blackness had faded to dark blue when the coach came to a halt. Through the window, Charlotte could vaguely make out the short canopy between the pitched roofs of the modest main station and the stationmaster's house. A busy day lay ahead. They would take the train from Spilsby to the market town Fursby, then on to Lincoln to meet the London and North Eastern Railway. "Mr. Perry rang less than 24 hours ago," she marvelled. Mr. Heaton opened the door, took the bags that Oswald proffered, and set them upon the cobblestones.
"Keep the rugs. Mr. Perry brought them for the train. I must go and fetch him now."
"I beg pardon for the wait," Oswald said as they shared an iron bench beneath the canopy, swaddled in rugs.
"The station master should open up in an hour or so, but I could rouse him, say that Lord Fosbury's wife..."
"No." He looked embarrassed. She had not intended to spit that out so sharply. Softening her voice, she said, "It's been a long time since I've watched the sun rise." "So Mr. Perry offered you a job?"
"He said he could always use good riders."
She hoped Mr. Perry had not made his commitment for her sake.
"It's an answer to prayer," Oswald went on. 7 years is a long time to clean stables."
Charlotte had to smile. "I should think 7 minutes would be a long time to clean them." He smiled back.
"I don't mind hard work, but there wasn't much leave for advancement. Mr. Douglas is as healthy as I am, even though he's been stable master since before I was born. Not that I would wish anything upon him."
"You're setting out on an adventure."
"I've put aside wages for years in hope of starting over in London. I can scarcely believe I'll soon be walking the streets of Oliver Twist and David Copperfield."
"You're a reader, then?"
"Aye, your ladyship." He paused. "You're setting out on an adventure as well. Are you at all afraid?"
Petrified, she thought, but she didn't wish to give vent to her fears. Not now, when any moment she could hear hoofbeats. Oswald gave her a sidelong look.
"The lamp belonged to Mr. Heaton. He lent it to me yesterday. Wouldn't want you to think I nicked it from his lordship."
"I would never have assumed so," Charlotte said, meaning it. It was obvious that this young man had character. Not that she had been the best judge over the years, but even an off-key piano could sometimes strike a proper chord. She lowered her chin to cover a yawn with the rug.
"Rest your eyes, your ladyship," Oswald said. "I'll keep watch."
"I'm quite sure I can't." But folding arms and lowering her chin again, she sank into a muddled half-slumber.
"Good morning."
She roused herself and looked up at a thick-set man in a coat and bowler hat.
"I'm Mr. Sparks. Would you care to wait inside?"
The town of Spilsby was waking to their backs. Sounds of wheels and hooves upon stones. St. James's 6 bells striking 7:15. "Thank you, yes." She gave Oswald a gentle elbow and smiled when he snorted awake. Inside the station house, Mr. Sparks offered tea. The familiar warmth of the cup in her hand was reassuring. Still, her insides flinched every time the door opened. A handful of passengers assembled upon the benches. Charlotte drew some curious looks, but no one ventured over. She did not think her nerves could stand the strain of polite chatter. The young man with her studied the door just as intently. "Roger can make a scene, but he cannot force us to return," she had to remind herself. She felt better at the sight of Mr. Perry approaching. Charlotte held out her hands. He set his grip upon the floor and took them.
So, here you are. Please forgive my not accompanying the coach. I took to heart Lord Fosbury's threat to have me arrested.
I understand. Releasing her hands, he took a purse from his waistcoat pocket and turned to Oswald.
Mr. Green, go and purchase 3 first-class tickets to King's Cross.
Oswald looked at the coins in his hand.
3rd is fine for me, sir.
Mr. Perry smiled.
Just don't become accustomed to it, my good man. Are you all right, Lady Fosbury?
He said to Charlotte as they shared a bench.
Quite, thanks to you.
She had to address the question in the back of her mind. Did you hire Oswald for my sake? He shook his head.
My couriers oft-times deliver money and valuables, thus integrity is vital. I can teach a man to ride, but not to be honest. I was having my pipe in the courtyard when he rode up. His horsemanship was obvious.
But how could you discern his integrity?
After I read Lord Fosbury's letter, I offered him £5 to get word to you that I would take this to the local authorities. He turned down the money and warned that Lord Fosbury and the chief constable sometimes ride together. Whilst I pondered what to do, he came up with the plan. I had given no indication that he would be offered a position.
God sent you and Oswald, Charlotte said. You're surely angels.
Mr. Perry chuckled.
Mrs. Perry would beg to differ.
Midday London glistened from morning rains. 2 grey horses pulled the coach along Euston Street, among hansoms and drays and costermonger carts and omnibuses. Charlotte alternated between watching familiar landmarks and Oswald's glowing face. Up the Strand toward Wellington, Charlotte kept her eyes to the window and was rewarded with the sight of the 6 Ionic limestone columns of the Lyceum's grand portico. The coach rocked to a gentle stop. The cabbie opened the door and offered his hand. She handed him her bag, stepped out onto the pavement and turned. Both men were half rising as if to accompany her.
Kind sirs, it is time to return to your lives.
She smiled at Oswald.
Your new life.
Your bag,
they said in unison,
is not heavy. I shall give your names to the box office, and I do hope you will attend a performance as my guest and stay for refreshments backstage. And Mr. Perry, that includes Mrs. Perry, of course.
We should be delighted,
Mr. Perry said, settling back into his seat. Oswald nodded.
Godspeed, Lady Fosbury.
Thank you, she said. But it's Ward, if you please. I left Lady Fosbury back in Lincolnshire.
A sunken-cheeked woman was mopping the lobby's marble floor with wide swabs.
Waste of effort, she hissed through gaping teeth. Tonight there'll be 2,000 pairs of boots mucking it up.
Good morning.
The woman turned, hand to throat.
Ouch! You gave us a fright.
I beg your pardon.
Oh, no matter. Box office ain't open for...
She studied Charlotte's face.
Would you be Mrs. Charlotte Ward?
Yes, here to see Mr. Irving.
The aged eyes travelled the length of her, or rather, the breadth of her. Charlotte stood straighter.
Will you direct me to his office?
I'm here, Charlotte.
Henry Irving strode into the lobby from the side door. He was as handsome as ever, even though some grey had cropped up in the hair parted above his long face.
Good morning, Henry.
He took her proffered hand in both of his.
So, Mr. Perry pulled it off.
It was quite an enterprise.
You put on some weight.
He was not one to mince words.
Too much? She asked, resisting the urge to fold her arms across her body.
"'Tis the bane of being woman, Mr. Irving,' the cleaner offered. "'My George once could put both hands round my middle.'
He gave her a bemused look, and she snorted and returned to mopping.
"'I've had nothing but tea since your letter,' Charlotte said. "'I'm determined to make myself thin again. "'And I intend to buy a corset.'
"'No, not necessary,' Henry said. "'Our dressers will truss you up.'
Charlotte's breath caught in her throat. I may stay then?
But of course, it's an honor to have you. Can you be ready Saturday night?
3 days away. I can be ready tonight.
Finally, he smiled. We must inform the newspapers and squeeze in a rehearsal with the cast. I'll have someone carry you over to the Mona Hotel in Covent Garden. Rehearsal at 1 o'clock on Friday.
With a wave of his hand, he turned. Charlotte watched his retreating back. This is as a dream, she said. The woman with the mop snorted.
If this be a dream, dearie, give us a good pinch.
Chapter 4. Backstage at the Lyceum was an anthill of activity 1 hour before curtain. Actors and musicians, wardrobe and hairdressers, managers and stagehands travelled the labyrinthine passageways and narrow staircases at half trot. The hairdresser had just left Charlotte's dressing room. A silvery crown perched upon her coiled hair. She closed the door and practiced projecting her voice while using only the upper portion of her body.
Dr. Foster went to Gloucester in a shower of rain. He stepped in a puddle right up to his middle and never went there again.
A whalebone corset constrained her lower lungs. She had arrived 3 hours ago in order to have the full attention of the dressers. Tucking and tugging and grunting, they had managed to transform her into Gertrude without having to let out any seams in the loose-flowing blue brocade gown. Her hands went often to her waist. The firmness was comforting. The hunger pangs had finally eased last night, along with a blinding headache. How good to feel in control. She could do this for as long as it took.
Come in, she said, when someone rapped at her door.
One of the assistants, a wizened, affable fellow named Bayard Rook, entered with a bouquet of roses.
From His Highness, he announced.
How lovely.
It seemed unpatriotic to set the vase upon the floor with a half dozen others, so she pushed aside jars and bottles upon the dressing table. Welcome back, the card read simply. Signed, Edward. Edward VII, Prince of Wales, was a great patron of the arts. The flowers meant he and his entourage would be in his usual box one. She was accustomed to royalty in the audience. This was, after all, London. She continued breathing techniques.
Dr. Foster went to Gloucester.
Half an hour later, Mr. Rook knocked again and stuck his head around the door.
It's time.
Meaning time to assemble in the green room. Her fluttering of nerves mingled with relief that the waiting would soon be over.
You're stunning, Mrs. Ward, Geoffrey Fisher called from his open door.
He would soon be King Claudius to her Queen Gertrude. He sat upon a stool as a woman dresser stitched an apparent rent in the sleeve of his tunic.
Why, thank you, Mr. Fisher, Charlotte said, and floated down the corridor, buoyed by his compliment.
The hum of conversation met her ears. A pair of young actresses stood at the green room door, wearing silks appropriate for ladies of the court.
Didn't realize it was missing until I looked into the mirror. They were cheap as last week's trout, but the jade matched my eyes.
Well, mind you keep the other, or the missing one will turn up next day. It always happens that way.
Mrs. Ward, exclaimed the one with green eyes. I didn't have the chance to speak with you yesterday. My aunt took me to see the octoroon when I was but 7. We waited at the stage door and you were so kind. I kept the programme you inscribed for me.
Charlotte smiled. And now here you are, an actress yourself. The young woman sighed.
Standing about with no lines.
Now there, William Shakespeare thought enough of your part to include it, so let's hold our heads up high, shall we?
Thank you, Mrs. Ward.
Smiling, the two stood aside to allow her entrance. Gentlemen and gravediggers, lords and ladies conversed in worn chairs and sofas before the fireplace, or sipped from beakers of water on the table. There was no need to be silent as yet, for from the theatre came faint sounds of voices and shuffling of feet.
Most actors had been in the production since its inception. Thus, there were few frenzied scans of play scripts.
"Ah, and there you are," called Tom Fawkes, soon to play Horatio.
He crossed the room and handed her an envelope bearing her name. The sight of the familiar bold script sent a chill through her.
"Where did you get this?"
"I was the first one here."
He motioned toward the far wall.
"It was attached."
Through the costumed bodies, she spotted what appeared to be her trunk. Her constrained lungs labored to pull in breaths. Surely he would not give up so easily and extend an olive branch. Did he intend to shake her nerve? Brows rose beneath Tom's flat cap.
"Mrs. Ward?"
"Just an old acquaintance, if you'll excuse me."
Walking over to a relatively quiet corner of the room, she broke the seal and opened the vellum paper. She could not stop herself from reading. If he were out there in the audience, she must know.
"My dearest Charlotte, you did not think I would miss your opening night, did you? I understand aging has been difficult, but I believed you above corrupting the virtue of a servant barely out of boyhood. Alas, the proverb rings true. The leopard cannot change its spots. I am too decent a man to exact revenge, hence your trunk. However, in my grief, I did pour out my heart to a very sympathetic reporter for the Daily Telegraph."
She gasped. Conversations tapered. Eyes turned toward her. Mr. Irving entered in flat cap and a short coat befitting the prince. He looked about and barked.
"And who died, pray?"
"It's nothing," Charlotte said when nods were directed her way.
She forced a smile. "A ghost from the past. Prince Hamlet and I have that in common." That brought on a smattering of laughter. Henry crossed over to her and said,
"Your husband?"
She hesitated. Nodded.
"Give it to me."
He crossed over to the fireplace and threw page and envelope into the flames. Upon his return, he quoted one of his lines.
"The play's the thing, yes?"
"Yes, I won't allow him to win."
He nodded.
"And so he shan't."
"The play's the thing,"
Charlotte said under her breath, and then again. Stagehands sprang into action once the blue velvet curtain ended Act 1, Scene 1. Thanks to ingenious rolling platforms, the exterior of Denmark's royal castle became the interior room of state in seconds.
"Shall we, my dear?"
Geoffrey Fisher asked in the wing. Charlotte tucked her hand into his arm. They walked onto stage right and over to gilded thrones. Henry Irving stepped to his mark and winked at her. Her heart welled with gratitude. She would be the best Gertrude ever played. He would not regret believing in her. The curtain rose. And then, miracle of miracles, hearty applause. Not for me, Charlotte thought, but when Mr. Fisher pressed her hand into his side, she knew that it was. She could feel her face glowing. "What have I ever done to deserve such grace, Father?" Her prayer was brief, for the audience was silencing. She took as much breath as the corset allowed and delivered her first line.
"Good Hamlet, cast thy knighted colour off, and let thine eye look like a friend on Denmark."
The scene went well. She was the Queen of Denmark, not Charlotte, aging, unloved, and betrayed. The applause as the curtain lowered was intoxicating. She could have danced for joy. "Do you hear, Roger?" She would not appear again until Act 2, Scene 2, which gave her time to picture the aftermath of Roger's deed. The Daily Telegraph was well circulated. Lies set in newsprint might as well be carved in stone. Other publications would follow suit. Yes, she could fight to clear her name, which would amount to a retraction on some later page, but she would be fighting against the adage of where there is smoke, there is fire. Who had the most credibility? A respected member of the peerage, or a thrice married actress? And how long before the gossip reached Cheltenham? Another chill caught her, though the theatre wing seemed as hot as an oven. She wouldn't believe it. But why would she not? They were essentially strangers. Too soon, the curtain opened again on a castle room of state, where Claudius and Gertrude would ask courtiers, Rosencrantz and Guildenstern, to seek out the source of Hamlet's distress. Charlotte's distress was acute. Sweat trickled between her shoulder blades. The gaslights made her nauseous. But she kept her eyes upon Geoffrey Fisher as he began his lines.
Welcome, dear Rosencrantz and Guildenstern.
She had performed in far worse condition. Hives, a broken ankle, toothache, even the onset of pneumonia. 4 months of morning sickness. Even so, she could not recall nausea this severe, nor such a lump in her chest. Silence. She blinked, looked about. Actors waited. Out in the darkened seats, uneasy anticipation was palpable.
Good gentleman, he hath much talked of you, she said hastily.
Too hastily. She could not believe this. Past fame or not, one more mishap and Henry would replace her with Mrs. Overton, who waited somewhere backstage. Taking a quick breath, she continued,
And sure I am.
What next? The actor who played Guildenstern held two discreet fingers beneath his chin. Charlotte was both grateful and resentful. This was a part she could play in her sleep.
Two men there are not living.
The lump welled from chest to throat. Nausea overwhelmed her. She gulped air, tried to continue. The young actors before her traded worried glances. She could picture Roger out there, smiling.
Two men there are not living, she repeated, digging fingernails into her palms. To whom he more adheres. It will please you.
The line was supposed to be, if it will please you. Those things happened. Never to her, but she knew that it was best to carry on.
To expend your time with us a while.
Guildenstern's eyes fairly bulged. She had left out a whole line. From a seat out in the darkened audience, surely no farther away than the third row, a pair of hands began clapping. That led to murmurs from all over and rustling in seats.
You're a professional, Charlotte reminded herself, blinking tears. What was the next line?
Curtain,
came from the wings. Mercifully, pulleys began humming, and the curtain started lowering. She buried her face in her hands. As curtain met stage, despair seized her with such violence that every nerve in her body felt on fire. Yet her teeth chattered, and she felt pressed upon from all sides, as if underwater. The pair who had dressed her, Mrs. Dowie and Miss Wren, hurried on stage. Mrs. Dowie touched her shoulder.
Come, Mrs. Ward, let us see after you.
Charlotte gaped at her. She was led to the wing in a fog. She felt damp cloth against her skin, clothes being loosened, others pulled over her head. Whimpering, she was escorted into a carriage. A ride through gaslit streets. A cot with starched sheets. A spoonful of bitter liquid pushed past her lips. And blessed nothing. As Charlotte eased into consciousness, dream characters floated about speaking bits and pieces of sentences. She had the vague notion of yet another carriage ride through dark streets. She had no concept of time save light and shadows. At length, she regained some lucidity and was informed by a Dr. Jacobs that she was in an isolation room at Royal Free Hospital in Hampstead.
You've been here 2 days. You spent 3 in a ward in St. Thomas's Hospital.
His brows joined and sprouted like weeds above narrow eyes, but his voice was soothing.
Reporters became nuisances, so you were brought here in secret, under the identity of Mrs. Iris Jones.
Why can't I remember? Charlotte asked.
You were treated with opium for exhaustion and melancholia.
Opium? I don't want...
I discontinued it when you arrived. I wish to see how you respond to bed rest.
That was a relief. She had witnessed the results of opium addiction firsthand.
I have very little money, a brooch and bracelet in my bag, wherever it is.
There is only a small fee for the use of this room, as technically you're not an isolation patient. Mr. Irving intends to pay it on behalf of the Lyceum and asked that we protect your identity.
How kind.
He asked me to assure you that the production went on the night of your unfortunate departure, and that your trunk and belongings from the hotel are being stored at the theatre.
Henry Irving is a good man.
Charlotte sighed. And I'm a charity case. Dr. Jacobs wagged a finger at her.
Few of us go through life without needing assistance at some time, Mrs. Ward. My mother was a widowed parlour maid, and her employer kindly paid for my education. No doubt you've helped others as well.
Charlotte thought, shook her head.
I'm afraid not. No little encouragements to fellow actors here and there, but nothing to the degree of your employer.
We do what we can, Mrs. Ward, and your time on earth is not up.
Being that poverty was all Charlotte could see for her future, it was unlikely she would be able to help anyone. But such thinking exhausted her, and she was grateful when Dr. Jacobs left and she could sink back into sleep. The following day, or it could have been the same day, for she had lost all sense of time, she tried to figure out what she would do after leaving the hospital. The thought of trying to find another acting job made her physically ill. Yet the thought of asking Roger to take her back was far worse, if he would even deign to do so. No letters arrived.
Few know you're here, Dr. Jacobs explained when Charlotte asked. I'm certain they're being held at St. Thomas's. Shall I inquire?
She was tempted. Perhaps some of her old acquaintances had written. Theatre people were generous as a rule. She had but to ask, and hospitality would be offered. But for how long? There was a not too fine line between houseguest and burden, especially when that houseguest was almost penniless. Self-recrimination filled her prayers. I never asked you once if Roger was the right man for me, or if it was your will that I should marry again at all. Her most frequent prayer was not for herself, however, but that the faculty of Cheltenham Ladies' College, 100 miles away in Gloucestershire, were too busy educating young minds to read theatre columns from London newspapers. Chapter 5. The sun had started glazing the neo-Gothic...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.